Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Killett, your host. Thanks so much for being here with us on this Tuesday, the day after. And if you know me, you know what the day after refers to, but I can't talk about the Boston Celtics on this program. Tim Staples is our guest, and it's Ask Me Anything this hour. And holy smokes, I just saw five calls come in. So people must have seen Tim on the screen, and they just started dialing. That means one line open, 888-318-7884. You want to talk about anything about the Catholic faith, you are welcome to call. 888-318-7884. Tim Staples is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of Behold Your Mother, a biblical Behold Your Mother is the title. The subtitle is A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. Hello, Tim. How are you?
That sounded like it was hard to come out.
It did. For some reason, that was giving me trouble.
You know, I know we're not a sports show, but I am happy that Boston won because now they have 18 pulling away from the Lakers' meager 15.
17. I think the Lakers have 17.
Oh, okay. I thought it was 15. But anyway, Boston is now ahead of the Lakers. And you know me, I root for anybody that's playing the Lakers.
Okay. So. That's a great policy. I love that policy. Also, Joe Mazzulla, the head coach of the Celtics, a big Catholic guy.
Yeah, and I read about that.
I saw that he his shirt that he wore what said, you know, for the post game.
Yeah.
Said, but first, let me thank God. Yeah. That's what it, in big white letters on the shirt. So that was very nice.
Fantastic.
The number here is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. If you have a question about the Catholic faith, you are welcome to call. Are you mellow right now? Or are you traveling? I feel like you're not traveling that
much.
Yeah,
I'm not. Not till next month. Not till July. So it's kind of nice. I'm hanging out with my kids and stuff.
Ah, very good. Very good. All right. Well, let's get to Lily in Indiana. We'll start in Indiana. Lily listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Lily,
let's
thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Thank you guys so much. I really appreciate it. And so my friend comes from a Methodist background, but she hasn't been to church since she was little. She is open to Catholicism and understands Mary and purgatory. She doesn't have her license quite yet, but when she does, she wants to come to my church. Until that happens, though, she still wants to keep holy the Lord's Day as best she can. So we've been doing Bible studies over video chat on Sundays.
Beautiful.
But this is really where I really need guidance. How can we better do this over the phone? Because right now we just kind of talk about whatever comes to mind. So, yeah, and thank you.
Yeah, that's, man, fantastic. That now is your friend... Is she, I'm trying to put her into an age category here. Is she not driving because she's not old enough yet to get her license?
Yeah, she's old enough, but just like, you know, just she hasn't gotten around to it. So like we're both like older teenagers.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Well, man, that's beautiful. It's wonderful to see Catholics out there evangelizing. But, you know, when it comes to a situation like that, of course, you're not required to do what you can't do. So if you can't get to Mass for various reasons, whether you're sick or whether in this case you can't drive, of course, you're not required. But for all Catholics listening, if you're in a situation like that, a wonderful thing to do, and now in this modern era, that we have masses online, you know, where you can go and see your local diocese most likely has various opportunities to watch Mass. Now, of course, that doesn't fulfill the Sunday obligation for those who can get to Mass. But if you can't get to Mass, that's a wonderful option. And you also have different apps and apostolates, and we happen to have one right here. His name is Carlo Broussard, who does reflections on the readings from the Mass of the day. So that's another thing that is really awesome, and I happen to know that Carlo is an extraordinary teacher. So you can check that out. I don't know what
SundayCatholicWord.com.
There you go. Yeah. SundayCatholicWord.com with Carlo Broussard. That's a wonderful way to keep up with the readings because you're going to have a world-class apologist giving you a reflection. And, you know, this isn't to put down any priests, because I know we have my pastor, for example, and I know several priests in this Diocese of San Diego who are absolutely phenomenal at preaching. But you don't often get, you know, a Sunday sort of reflection on the gospel and the readings from a PhD like Dr. Carlo Broussard, who, as you may know, he's one of our apologists, but he's also a newly minted PhD. So absolutely brilliant. So those are some of the options in order to keep up. And by continuing what you're doing, it's fantastic with your friend. Just in that one-on-one conversation, I think that's fantastic, because really that's the way evangelism happens. It's one-on-one, you sharing with your friend and listening as she shares with you. But those are some helps.
All right?
Yeah, sounds good. Thank you.
Okay, God bless you. Thank you very much for the call, Lily. It was delightful to talk with you. I'll give out the number, but... when Lily goes, there'll just be one line open, 888-318-7884. Everybody tried to get in here early with Tim today. I think they must have had their questions ready. let's go to Ryan in Midland, Texas, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Welcome back, Ryan. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
All right, I thought I'd call you guys because I have some free time at work right now.
Oh, I'm glad.
Great.
I'm glad you got a little break. All right, squeeze us in there. Go ahead and give us a question.
All right, Tim, I was wondering, I've heard it said that Mark's gospel was written first and that it's based on the preaching of St. Peter. Mm-hmm. But what I want to know is, are the other three gospels also based on the preaching of another apostle that's not Peter, or no?
Right. Great. Great question, Ryan. And by the way, there is difference of opinions among Catholics, and of course we're free to hold differing opinions on which gospel came first and the order in which they were written. I tend to believe, Ryan, the order that we just happen to have in our Catholic tradition, that is Matthew was written first, Mark, then Luke, and then John. But I know it's become very popular in the last, you know, 150 years to say Mark's gospel was written first. And there is some reason for that. I am personally... persuaded by Matthew being first. But that's not your question. Your question is a good one. Are all of the Gospels based on input of the apostles, right? Well, yes. And in order for an inspired author to be an inspired author, one of the criteria was he had to be in contact with one of the apostles. And in the case of Matthew, of course, Matthew is an apostle. So he is the apostolic source for Matthew's gospel. Mark, as you mentioned, it's not only the preaching of Peter, I would argue, Ryan, but the fact that Mark is said to be in for example, 1 Peter chapter 5, right around, where would that be? About verse, I want to say 14 and 15. It's right in there. Of 1 Peter, Mark is referred to as the beloved son of Peter. So he was a companion of St. Peter. So it was certainly based on Peter's preaching. But more than that, you have a sort of very close friendship. Mark was kind of Peter's secretary, so to speak. And so he had intimate knowledge, a very close relationship with St. Peter. So yes, Peter, and it's real, I will tell you this, Ryan, when you understand sort of the tradition behind the Gospels, it really helps in your study of the Gospels. You know, we know Matthew was, of course, written by Matthew, but it was also written in the context of writing to a Jewish Christian community, and you see that in Matthew's writings, Noah. It's awesome. You know, for example, we know the biggest issue among the Jewish Christian community in the first century was over authority. I mean, they had a problem with what was called the Judaizers, who threatened to tear the fledgling church apart, claiming that for the Gentiles in particular, but for Jews as well. In order to be a Christian, you first got to be a Jew, and you got to keep the Jewish law and go to the temple and especially be circumcised and so forth. And when you see that, Matthew, you understand why. You know, it was Peter who came in and put the hammer down on that false teaching at the First Church Council in Acts chapter 15. And so that's why in Matthew's gospel, you have such an emphasis, more so by far than any other the apostles, on Petrine authority. So you uniquely have in Matthew chapter 10, verse 2, Peter is called the first apostle. He comes right out and says it, protos, which means there, chief. He's the chief apostle. It's not first chronologically, because we know in John 1:41, Andrew was the first chronologically. I hope you're following me here. So Peter is declared there to be the first, that is the chief apostle. You have only in Matthew's gospel do you have, you know, Peter walking on the water in Matthew 14. Only in Matthew 16 do we have the keys of the kingdom. Only in Matthew 17 do you have Peter throwing in the hook, catching the fish that miraculously has money to pay the tax in the place of Jesus. Right there you have vicar of Christ right there. And on we can go in Matthew's gospel. Mark's gospel, you have none of that. As you pointed out, Ryan, because Mark gets the substance of his gospel from Peter, and Peter, we know, was an extremely humble man, so you don't have any of the Petrine text there. What you do have is Peter emphasizing all of the apostles, we would say the college of the apostles and their authority, and you see that in a special way in Mark chapter 6, when we have the feeding of the 5,000, and then afterward, when, you know, Jesus comes walking on the water, you notice in Matthew 14, it's Peter who steps out and miraculously walks on the water. Again, Matthew emphasizing Petrine authority. And then when he starts to go under, Jesus, in effect, says, nope, you're not going under. Get back up on top of those waves. And he supernaturally walks back to the boat with Jesus. I mean, right? But in Mark's gospel, look at Mark 6, 47 through 52. And it's incredible. What you see is all the apostles call out to Jesus. He stops, turns, steps into the boat, and the storm ceases, emphasizing all of the apostles rather than the emphasis on Peter. Now, they don't contradict each other. That's just different aspects of the same story that are being brought out for the particular community to whom the apostles are writing. And that's why it's important, Ryan, that we do understand that Peter is the source behind Mark's gospel. It is really, really helpful. Now, St. Luke got much of his gospel from St. Paul. And you say, well, wow, St. Paul, but he wasn't there. Well, yeah, but St. Paul received direct revelation from Jesus Christ. And so, yeah, you have St. Luke, who to some substantial, in some substantial way, got a lot of his stuff from St. Paul. Now, of course, we also know St. Luke interviewed eyewitnesses, he tells us in Luke chapter 1, so he no doubt conversed with the other apostles and with the Blessed Virgin Mary, we know from the intimate details he had of Mary's life and Christ's life as an infant. But then John's gospel, of course, you have John the Apostle, and we don't have time. We could spend the whole hour talking about the importance of St. Luke being a Gentile and the influence there, and St. John and his encounters with Cerinthus and the early Gnostics who denied the divinity of Christ, denied the real presence of our Lord in the Eucharist, and that's why you have in John's gospel the emphases on the divinity of Christ, the real presence of our Lord in the Eucharist in John 6, and a lot more because the Gnostics also denied the incarnation. We have the unique occurrence in John 1:14, and the Word was made flesh, not mentioned in any of the other Gospels. So, yeah, Ryan, all four of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, have at their sources either the fact that they are apostles in Matthew and John, or they are closely connected to and had a close relationship with the apostles in Mark, who was Peter's secretary, and St. Luke, who we know from the book of Acts, traveled with St. Paul. Anyway, that ought to get you started, Ryan.
Thanks, Ryan. That brings us to the break. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with more Ask Me Anything with Tim Staples on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live. Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at Magnificat.com.
Hi, this is Father Mike Schmitz. Please join me for Ascension's Bible in a Year and Catechism in a Year here on EWTN Radio. We're going through the entire Bible and the Catechism in 365 days. If you've ever wanted to understand what it means to be Catholic and allow those truths to shape your life, this is for you.
Bible in a Year and Catechism in a Year with Father Mike Schmitz. Tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Tim Staples is our guest. Tim will be among the speakers at our conference this year. It's coming up September 26th through 29th right here in sunny San Diego.
It's going to be awesome.
It is going to be awesome. Learn from me the parable sermons and conversations of Jesus Christ. Do you have a particular, do you know what you're talking about already?
I sure. Well, sometimes I know what I'm talking about.
I know, I mean. I don't mean it that way.
Yes, I'm going to be talking about the parable of the, I will call it the Lord of the Vineyard, or more popularly, the owner of the vineyard from Matthew chapter 21. I'm going to talk about the relationship between Catholics and Jews, how Jews play into that awesome parable. And so I'm going to have to kind of steer that fine line between, you know, going too far, and unfortunately in our history sometimes Jews have been called Christ killers and that sort of thing, and of course that's absolutely false, misses the whole point of that the message there. So I'll be talking about that, but more importantly I'm going to talk about how to interpret the parables and how some folks get in trouble by going too far in one direction or the other direction, but I'm going to give you some real Catholic clues as to how to both stay out of trouble and really appreciate, understand the parables and what it means for your spiritual life.
And that's what we're talking about the whole weekend, the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. So, I mean, just multiply that by a bunch of other talks as well that we'll get into the... It's nice to spend the time to just talk about what Jesus said. I'm really looking forward to that.
I am too, and I'm also looking forward to Scott and Kimberly, Scott and Kimberly Hahn both being with us, because I got to tell you, the secret behind the Hahn family is the mom.
Oh, she
is a absolute powerhouse. If you have never heard her speak before, you will want to come just for that, because she will melt your heart, I will guarantee
you. Oh, how beautiful. Well, check it out at CatholicAnswersConference.com. We'd love it if you'd come. CatholicAnswersConference.com. Ask Me Anything means anyone can call up with any question they've got about the Catholic faith, whether that person is Christian or not, whether that person believes in God or not. Anybody can call with a question. 888-318-7884. We're going to Chattanooga, Tennessee now. Noah is listening on YouTube in Chattanooga, Tennessee. Noah, thank you very much for the call. Go ahead with your question for Tim Staples.
Hey, guys. Thank you very much. I appreciate you having me on. So, essentially, I'm a recent convert from being a Reformed Baptist to the Catholic faith.
And welcome
home.
One
of the big points I've been...
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. It's been great.
Yes.
One of the big points I've been challenged on by my various Protestant friends and family is the issue of assurance of salvation. So essentially, I know it's kind of a long shot, but I'm just wondering how, as Catholics, we should formulate the doctrine of assurance of salvation And how should we go about talking about that with our Protestant friends and family?
Oh, yeah. Well, brother, welcome home, number one. And I don't know if you know much of my background, but I was born and raised a once saved, always saved Southern Baptist. Got saved in 1974 when I was 10 years old. And notice how I get that country drawl going when I talk about that. Boulevard Baptist Church in Falls Church, Virginia. But anyway, I just absolutely love my evangelical tradition that I came from. And then I later became a member of the Assemblies of God, was a youth pastor, and there I became Arminian. I did switch from my eternally secure upbringing to an Arminian position with the Assemblies of God, even though in the Assemblies you don't really have a position officially. In the Assemblies, a good, I would say, majority have the Arminian position among Protestants. For those who don't know, that means you can lose your salvation. And so becoming Catholic, of course, you know, I got the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And really, I think in the church, we have the way of really not going too far, kind of like I was talking about my talk's going to be at the conference, not going too far in either direction. But here's what I do, brother, when I'm talking to my Baptist friends or Protestant friends in general, I start with the assurance of salvation. Because as you, I'm sure you know, brother, the Catholic Church teaches we can have an assurance of our salvation right in line with 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, where St. John says, "These things have I written unto you, that you may know that you have eternal life," right? Now, we believe that knowledge is not a sort of strict metaphysical certainty in the way that John Calvin taught, that you can have, and the Westminster Confession says, as you know, brother, an infallible certainty that we are saved. No, we cannot have that apart from a private revelation, which is a possibility. You know, as you may know, brother, the three seers at Fatima, for example, got a private revelation that they were going to heaven. And that is valid, real. And even at the Council of Trent, when it condemned eternal salvation, it has a little parenthetical statement, barring a private revelation, right? So you can have a private revelation that you are, in fact, going to go to heaven, as I mentioned with the three seers of Fatima. But generally speaking, right, the Council of Trent, as well as the last 500 years of Catholic teaching, has emphasized that we can have a certainty, but it is a moral certainty and not a metaphysical certainty. Now, what does that mean? All right. A moral certainty means, and I like to use 1 John 5:13 as the example, because notice it says, "These things have I written unto you that you may know that you have eternal life." But in the next verse, verse 14, it says, "And this is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if he hears us, we know we have whatever we have asked of him." Notice there's sort of an analogy here between the certainty we can have concerning our salvation and the certainty we can have concerning our petitions, right? Now, we do not have, and even my Protestant friends will say to me, unless you're a member of one of those name it and claim it, you know, television preacher churches, and we need to do some more apologetics there. But the, you know, bottom line, the overwhelming majority of Christians understand that, you know, everything you ask is not going to be given to you. There is that little parenthetical statement there in verse 14. If it's according to his will, he hears us, right? So in other words, it's a confident assurance that John is talking about here, and not a sort of strict metaphysical certainty. And you can know that from the same letter of John, because, you know, John starts out there in 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9. If, he puts lots of ifs, that little Greek word aeon there, it's not a two-letter word in Greek, it's a three-letter word. Ours is if, the Greek word is aeon. If, right, we walk in the light as he is in the light, We have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, continues to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we do not have sin, we are liars and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So notice how John has already put all those ifs and qualifiers saying, yeah, but you've got to keep your end of the bargain. Of course, entirely relying on God's grace and such. But you have to, right? 1 John chapter 3, verse 7. Skip forward a couple chapters, right? It's ha poyon tein dikaiosunein dikaios esten. That is, the one doing justification is just, right? Not just the one who believes. Justification, salvation, is something that we must do rather than just passively receive. And of course, that leads forward to 1 John chapter 5, which we'll have to get to after the break. Can you hang on there
for a minute? Noah. We'll be right back.
Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, bulk cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or visit whywearecatholic.com.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ, September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Noah's in Chattanooga, Tennessee, on the line with us. Tim Staples, our guest this hour. And the topic is assurance of salvation and how do we understand the Catholic view of our salvation. And Tim, you wanted to get back to the first letter of St. John, is that right?
Yeah. And I hope our brother is still with us. Are you still with us?
Noah?
I am.
Okay, great.
Okay, good. So... back to 1 John and what we were talking about, John makes very clear that when he's talking about, you know, in 1 John 5, verse 13, that you may know that you have eternal life, it's obvious that that doesn't have the implication of John Calvin, that this knowledge results in this strict, absolute metaphysical certainty. And what I do from there is show, and we could really spend some hours on this, brother, you and I, we could talk of how our relationship with Jesus is not based on just a one-time prayer, acknowledging Jesus Christ as the Son of God. That is absolutely foreign to John's mentality, even in this letter of 1 John, as well as to the entirety of the New Testament and Old Testament. But our relationship begins, no doubt, you know, with an act of faith. faith and baptism, the Catholic Church teaches, is the beginning of salvation. But salvation then is a process. And this is why you'll have in 1 John, for example, right after he makes that statement of 1 John 5:13, I write this to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, right? He then qualifies that, as we said in verse 14, this is the confidence that we have in him, right? But then he makes this statement in 1 John 5:18, where he says, all wrongdoing, actually, starting in verse 16, this is immediately after this discussion on this is the confidence we have in him. If anyone sees his brother, now he's talking about a Christian, committing a sin which is not a mortal sin or a sin that's not unto death, let him ask, and God will give him life, Zoe, the divine life, for those whose sin is not mortal. There is a sin which is mortal. I do not say that one is to pray for that. In other words, in our relationship with God, if I see Cy Kellett sinning a sin which is not a mortal sin, I can pray for him and make atonement for him, and life will be communicated to him. We can heal one another by God's grace working through us, of course, of sins that are not mortal. But if he commits a mortal sin, nope. I can't help you there. Now, I can pray for him that God would give him the grace of repentance, but he needs to go to confession to be restored in that situation. See, this is what John's getting at in verse 17. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin which is not mortal. We know that anyone born of God does not sin, but he who was born of God keeps him, and the evil one does not touch him. So notice there, whoever's born of God, Cy, can't sin. Now, brother, we have a contradiction here, because what did he already say in 1 John chapter 1, verse 8? If anyone says he has no sin, he is a liar, and the truth is not him. But then here he says, anyone born of God does not sin. What is he talking about? He's talking about mortal sin, because if you are born of God, if you are in a state of grace, my friend, you don't commit mortal sin. If you do, then you're cut off from the life of God. That's the whole point here in 1 John, and you have to be restored. Hence, we have a sacrament called confession. We got that in 1 John chapter 1. He doesn't talk about the sacrament per se, but he says you have to confess your sins in order to be forgiven. And then, so we know that anyone born of God does not sin, but he who is born of God keeps him. He who was born of God keeps him, and the evil one does not touch him, right? So what is John talking about here? A relationship with Jesus Christ. And we could go through Galatians, we could go through Romans, and you see, I'll just mention real briefly the book of Galatians, because of course Galatians 2:16, a man is justified by faith apart from works of law, that along with Romans 3:28 and elsewhere in Romans 1:17 were some of Luther's favorites. But what is he talking about in Galatians when he's talking about that we're justified by faith apart from works of law? Well, as you, I'm sure, know, brother, he's not saying that no works are necessary for salvation whatsoever, nor is he saying we don't have to continue to cooperate with a life of grace. He is not. In fact, the whole context of Galatians and Romans is set in the context of a heresy that I mentioned earlier in this broadcast, the heresy of the Judaizers, who were teaching, it's great that you believe in Jesus, but you also have to go back, keep the law, be circumcised, and so forth in order to be saved. Paul is saying, no, if you're trying to be saved by the works of the law, you're denying Jesus Christ. Now, that doesn't mean works in general, because Romans, for example, makes very clear, and just in a moment I'll show you in Galatians as well, Romans says in chapter 2, verse 6 and 7, God will reward each man according to his works. To him who continues in good works, his reward shall be glory, incorruption, and eternal life. Eternal life is a reward of good works, of course accomplished in him, with him, and through him. The key to the works of the law, That was attempting to be saved apart from Christ, going back to the law that doesn't exist any longer. The Jewish law, the works of law that have been abrogated in Christ. So anyone who attempts, and that's the key here in the New Testament, anyone who attempts to be justified apart from Christ, whether that be by the works of the law or works done by nature, as the Council of Trent defined infallibly in Session 6 on justification, Canon 1, the Council of Trent said, if anyone attempts to be justified by the works of law or by nature, let him be anathema, right? This is what was happening in the Galatian church, is these were Christians. They had begun in the spirit, as Paul will say, but they were being tempted to go back to the law to attempt to be justified apart from Christ, and Paul hammers that. And let me just pick up here. Brother, I wish we had more time, but we don't. But I always like to take my friends, my Protestant friends, to Galatians 3:1, where St. Paul says, "Oh, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, before whose eyes Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified," of course, referring to the holy sacrifice of the Mass. "Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun with the Spirit, are you now ending?" And that Greek word there, ending, means seeking perfection. Are you seeking to be made perfect by the flesh? Did you experience so many things in vain, if it really is in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Right? "Thus Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness." Right? So notice he says you've begun in the Spirit, meaning these people are already saved, baptized, justified, but he is fearing that they are going to lose their state of grace by turning away from Christ and attempting to be justified apart from him. And that leads to Galatians 5. "For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand fast, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Now I, Paul, say to you that if you receive circumcision, Christ will be of no advantage to you. I testify again to every man who receives circumcision, he's bound to keep the whole law." You are severed from Christ. Sorry, Calvin, right? You're severed from Christ. The once saved, always saved thing is obliterated here. You are severed from Christ. You who would attempt to be justified by the law, you are fallen from grace. "For through the Spirit, by faith, we wait for the hope." Hupa ka eis de kaiosune. The hope of justification. When you're hoping for something, that means you don't have it yet, as Paul says in Romans 8:24. "For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is of any avail, but faith working through love." You were running well. Look at verse 7. "Who hindered you from obeying the truth?" Right? So the warning is you must continue to walk in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And if you do not, if you attempt to be justified either by works of law or, as Council of Trent says, by nature, you will be lost. And finally, Galatians 6:7, I think he wraps up his argument when St. Paul says this, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap." If a man continues to sow to the flesh, now that can be by, you know, attempting the works of the law or simply sins of the flesh, as Paul will really flesh out, right? Pun intended, in Romans 8, verses 1 through 17. But he says, if you continue to sow to the flesh, you shall from the flesh reap death. But if you continue, notice, my brother, continue. This is a relationship with Jesus Christ, not a one-time prayer. If you continue to sow to the Spirit, you shall from the Spirit or of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Therefore, brethren, Do not lose hope, but continue, he says. And if you continue in your relationship with Jesus, you will be saved. That's kind of a paraphrase there of verse 9. So the key is our assurance is not rooted in our flesh. It's not rooted in us. It is entirely rooted in Jesus Christ, who is our strength. He is our power. He is the only way to salvation. But he asks us to choose him and to choose to continue to walk with him. Otherwise, yes, we can choose to walk away. As Jesus said in Revelation 2:10, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." At any rate, that ought to get you started, brother.
Thank you so much for the call. And again, welcome home to the Catholic Church. No, we got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more. Ask Me Anything with Tim Staples on Catholic Answers Live.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the biggest mistakes a Christian can make is to try to do good without God's help. Saint Therese said, "When we trust only ourselves and not God, our soul becomes incapable of virtue." Her remedy? Works of charity. And the greatest work of charity is to share the gospel. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we encourage you to share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
EWTN, Heavenly Hints.
Baptism, Eucharist, Confirmation. These are sacraments of initiation. Did you know you can renew at least two of your sacraments every day? Let bathing, swimming, and showering take you back to those first drops of baptismal water that washed away original sin and gave you new birth in the Holy Spirit. When you eat and drink to nourish your physical body, remember daily our Holy Eucharist that nourishes your life of faith.
Tim Staples is our guest. It's Ask Me Anything. If you've got a question about the Catholic faith, whether you're Catholic or not, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Next hour, Dr. Carlo Broussard will be here, and we'll continue. So lots of opportunity to get your question answered today. We're going to Birmingham, Alabama now. Amber is watching on YouTube. Amber, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Hi, all. I am a huge fan of Tim, and you saw it.
Well, thank you, Amber.
And I also have a Southern Baptist background.
Oh, beautiful.
And I thankfully was welcomed into the Catholic Church and confirmed into the Catholic Church this last Easter.
Praise God.
But my whole family is, thank you so much. My whole family is still Southern Baptist and non-denominational. And Tim, since you were so successful in evangelizing your family, I was hoping you would have some tips for me.
Yes. First of all, thanks for calling in, Amber. And I always love hearing from folks who come from a similar background that I do, because there's a certain affinity there, as you would probably agree with. But Amber, I tell you, I have for many years used as an axiom when it comes to evangelizing family that you have to scratch where it itches. Si has heard me say this 100 times, but well, what do I mean by that? Well, only the person you're talking to really knows where they itch, right? And so the key for me, and I found that to be a key for my whole family, was really letting them tell me where they itch. And that's really what evangelization is in my book. You start a conversation. I use the example of Jesus in John chapter 4 with the Samaritan woman at the well, right? Notice Jesus didn't approach and just begin the dialogue, you know, I say kind of tongue in cheek, "Hello, Samaritan woman at the well. I'm God. How are you?" Right? Now, of course, I'm the second person of the Blessed Trinity, relationally distinct from the Father and Holy Spirit, but one in nature, right? Of course. And by the way, I've been incarnate, and I've acquired a human nature. You know, Amber, of course he's not going to do that. You wouldn't know what she's talking about. But what does he do? He starts his conversation with, give me a drink of water. And that's what I tried to do with my family. It was really a matter of me explaining, yes, why I did what I did. But the most important thing to me was understanding where they had questions. So whether it was my mom, my dad, my three brothers, my sisters-in-law, my nephews, it doesn't matter. It's more about not, you know, it's St. James who says we are to be slow to speak, quick to hear. It really is. Evangelism is a huge, it has a huge amount to do. This is why Cy Kellett, I'm actually a fan of the synodal approach that I know a lot of people don't like, and I absolutely love it, because I do think you have to listen. Even if you're in leadership in the church, you actually have to listen to people and get where they are, and then you bring the gospel. And you'll find that you bring the gospel more effectively when you let the other person tell you exactly where they are, like the Samaritan woman at the well. But of course, you have to elevate the conversation. So the idea is, Amber, that you talk to them, let them talk, let them unspool. That's what I did. If my dad ranted about 20 things that he hated about the Catholic Church, and if you knew my dad, he did not like the Catholic Church, Cy Kellett and Amber. He did not, and he made no bones about it. But I didn't respond to everything. I just picked one thing that said, you know, Dad, boy, you know, I agree with you about so much of what you said, but let me share with you something that I've learned about this. And you share. And you know what you find, Amber, is you don't, I think one of the big mistakes we make as evangelizers is thinking we have to answer every single point, and we don't. You do not have to answer every single point. You have to keep the dialogue going, answering points that you know you can answer well, and then keep the dialogue going. And what you find, this is what I found, Amber, is over time, the 19 other things that my dad or my brothers threw at me didn't matter so much anymore, because now we have a conversation based on a point where we both agree, hey, this is an interesting point of conversation, and we let it go. And you let the Holy Spirit work. And I'll tell you what, Amber, another thing we have to do is acknowledge that God is the one who brings the increase. As St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, right? He says, Apollo waters, I plant the seed, but it's God who gives the increase, right? We cooperate, but it is God who ultimately is the first cause of salvation. We're secondary causes, yes, but he is the first cause. He's the one with the power. He's the one that brings them home. So keep the dialogue going. And I'll tell you something else that happens, Amber, is when you focus on the other, if we can do that in evangelization, and you're not about answering every single point, because you know what happens, Amber, is pride builds up. And you start getting into arguments instead of really ministering to the other person. And that's a quick way to cut grace off from the conversation. Because when it becomes about Amber or it becomes about Tim Staples, we lose it. But when the other that you're talking to really knows that you're about them, and if they've had enough, Amber, stop. Oh my goodness, do not keep evangelizing when you get the sense that the other side is frustrated. I recommend, you know, hey, let's have a beer or whatever the situation is. Let's talk Boston Celtics. Man, that was a great series, Cy Kellett tells me, if you know what I mean. So those are some of the keys. Now, of course, we have to be well-formed in our faith, Amber, and you're doing that. I recommend Catholic.com. We've got hundreds of thousands of pages of free information for you there. We've got lots of books and so forth. You know, we have the answers to pretty much anything you can come up with that you need help with, and we're here for you, Amber. But evangelization is all about allowing the Holy Spirit to work through you and to, as St. Paul says, bring that final increase. Does that make sense, Amber?
Yes, sir. And I just want to say thank you to all of you so much. Y'all are so formative in your website and in my conversion as well. And I really appreciate your help.
Well, thank you, Amber. Thanks very much. Do you have a copy of Tim's book, Behold Your Mother?
No, sir, I do not.
Well, we'd like to send it to you. If you want to just hang on, we'll send you a copy of Tim's book, Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines, in part because you're just so nice to us, Amber. So hang on, and we'll send it to you. I'm going to see if I can get some more questions answered by Tim here. Daniel is in Keller, Texas, watching on YouTube. Daniel, thank you for calling. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Hi, Tim. Do you hear me?
Yes. Welcome, brother. What's on your mind?
Hey, so this kind of piggybacks off of two questions ago.
Okay.
But recently, I had a dialogue with some Free Grace Baptists, and when I was bringing up the warning passages about falling away or the passages that you brought up about confession for forgiveness,
yes,
they employed a distinction called, this is basically how they described it to me.
Yes.
Judicial forgiveness takes place once for all at the time of conversion,
right,
and parental forgiveness takes place every time a believer confesses and forsakes his sin. So they're basically saying once you're saved, you're always saved.
Right.
The reason you confess after your sins is so God forgives you from the punishments he might give you in this life.
Right.
And so the chapter and verse they gave me was John chapter 13, verses 6 to 10.
Oh, the washing of the feet.
The washing of the feet. And they said that this is their lens by which they interpret all of these warning passages so they can explain it away.
Right.
Because Jesus says, once you're washed once, you know, I don't need to wash your head again. You only need to wash your feet.
Right.
And they're
right.
saying that that creates that distinction between the two types of forgiveness. I'm not really sure how to respond to this.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you could help me out.
Sure, absolutely. And of course, those are arbitrary distinctions that are not found in Scripture. And I would point out to you, this might not be the way to start it in your conversation with a Baptist, but that is a classic example of eisegesis, and that is reading into the text of Scripture stuff that just ain't there. For example, when you go to the confession Scripture that I reference there in 1 John chapter 1, as well as back up to 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, there is no distinction here. Because he says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And that fellowship is with God, right? And the blood of Jesus Christ continues to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, how do you get out of that? That no, it's not all unrighteousness. It only has to do with, like what the Westminster Confession says, your fellowship with God in this life, being in friendship and fellowship with God in this life, not the next life, because that's already taken care of when you accept Christ. But the problem is, that's not what John says. He says cleanses you of what? All unrighteousness, right? And then you move forward. If we say we have no sin, we're a liar and truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us, here it is again, of all unrighteousness. Now, I was raised with that teaching in the Southern Baptist Communion. It's what I believed as a child. But unfortunately, it just doesn't stand up to the scrutiny of sacred Scripture. Now, from there, what I would do is go to some texts of Scripture where you really can't get around the fact of what the text is saying. For example, in 2 Peter chapter 1. Now, follow me on this. Verse 2. This is 2 Peter 1, verse 2. Now, this is Peter's introduction, right? He's writing a pastoral letter here. He says, may grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Unfortunately, we're running out of time. I'll have to fast forward here. If you compare 2 Peter 1, 2 through 5, with then 2 Peter chapter 2, 20 through 22, he makes very clear that we can be in a state of knowledge and grace and in a relationship with Jesus Christ, but we can forfeit that state If after 2 Peter 2:20, having escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, we're entangled, the latter state becomes worse than the former, right? The dog has returned to his vomit. The sow, having been washed, has returned to the mire. It's those kind of texts that you simply cannot use those principles of the Baptists. They just don't work.
Right back with more Catholic Answers Live.